All right, let's do this naturally. Very natural handshake. Very natural. Very natural.
Cool. All right, thanks.
Grew up in Chilton, same town as you.
Yeah.
Pretty boring place. Home of the wiffle ball, though. Yeah. So.
That's what I say, too, as like a branding thing.
Yeah, I know. People are like, what? I'm like, look at the ball. They don't even have it on the ball anymore, though. They took the...
Oh, they did?
They took it off.
I must be seeing some...
Yeah, we just did a bit on the show where Monet Davis, you know, the Little League pitcher, the girl
who... Yeah, the phenom. Yeah.
Who, like, pitched a complete game two-hitter or whatever. She was on, so we did a bit where she pitches to Jimmy with wiffle balls.
Mm-hmm.
And then rehearsal, it wasn't the right kind of wiffle ball. It was, like, the big one. And then they hit the one with all the holes in it. I was like, no, you got to get the real wiffle ball. This is hometown pride.
Yeah.
So I really made like a big deal about it. So I got somehow they got a bucket of real wiffle balls, and I looked on the back. It doesn't say Shelton. It's probably too expensive to put the name on there.
Yeah, now. That's a lot of ink.
anyway, nothing really interesting, but definitely watched a lot of SNL reruns and probably all that. I didn't even get Nickelodeon, but when I'd go to my grandma's house, I'd watch Kenan and Kel. Because it was like SNL for kids.
Were your parents comedy fans, or you just kind of found that off on a...
No, I feel like they laugh at stuff, but my dad is big into like... It's weird because he wasn't even that old at the time. He was born in 1954, but he loves Dean Martin and like Abbott and Costello. All stuff from the previous generation, yep. So... he would show me stuff, so I was watching stuff from, like, I don't even know, the 1940s or something.
Did you get it?
Yeah, I thought it was funny. I mean, who doesn't think the Three Stooges and Abbott and Costello are funny? Mm-hmm. It's pretty basic stuff.
So that's entering your brain, and then you're kind of finding other, like, SNL, maybe The Simpsons or...
Oh, definitely The Simpsons, yeah. Seinfeld, all that stuff in high school.
The traditional.
Weirdly, I got really into, like... When I was in high school, I'd watch like Nick at Night, so I'd watch All in the Family and Sanford and Son and Mary Tyler Moore, Dick Van Dyke. I loved those shows. I was the biggest loser in high school. I liked classic rock and I liked the Dick Van Dyke show.
Yeah.
And I would tell all, I was like, you guys are wasting your time. Like Dave Matthews Band, man, and Bob Dylan, man. That's where it's at. And no one got it.
Yeah.
They thought I was an idiot. They're like, what are you doing? Watching Nick at Night and stay up to watch All in the Family. I remember when it was like a Super Bowl party. I was at my friend's house during halftime. I made them switch it to Mary Tyler Moore Marathon on TV Land. And they were like, what the fuck is this? In my head, I was like, this is my chance. All these dudes, I'm going to turn them over to like the Mary Tyler Moore show. Like, no, put on, like, the halftime show or, like, football.
So you're consuming it? Like, are you trying to imitate it, too? Like where's it coming out?
Probably, I didn't really think about doing comedy or anything probably till maybe sophomore, junior year of high school.
Okay.
It was actually Stell. She was our old journalism teacher.
Absolutely.
She kind of pushed me to it.
Isn't it great when teachers can kind of create, like, I mean, we were a couple years apart, but in the same journalistic, like, classroom, they create that form and everyone wants to hang out there because there's so much creativity going on.
No, it was awesome.
Like, it was just...
That was, like, the first time where I was, like, I did, like, a funny thing, like, a funny project. Instead of, like, just doing a standard assignment, I, like, sort of did a funny take on it and... She loved it, and she was, like, raving about it. I was like, oh.
What was that?
It was Taming of the Shrew. And the assignment was, like, who would you have play the characters in Taming of the Shrew if it was, like, a movie nowadays? And, you know, everyone was like, Leonardo DiCaprio would play so-and-so.
Yeah.
But I did yeah. So, like, it was right during the Clinton-Lewinsky scandal. So, okay. I worked all the characters... from that story into Taming of the Shrew. It sounds incredibly lame right now as I'm talking about it, but it was, you know, it was like, it was interesting and it was kind of funny. It kind of worked weirdly. I don't even remember what happens in Taming of the Shrew, but it weirdly made sense because there's like all these, you know, scandal and drama and stuff.
I feel like that's where a lot of comedy comes out of, is that combination of seemingly
two things separate. And you mash them together. That's basically what comedy is.
It's good to know.
That's what a joke is, I guess. It's taking two things and mashing them together.
Okay.
It's a very sad way of looking at comedy. It's more than that.
Stell's like feedback of, you're not that weird, like kind of.
Well, it's cool because it was like, A, you're doing something funny. B, you don't have to really do an assignment. Like, you don't have to really, like in college, I did not, like I was a TV major, first of all, so of course I did nothing. But anytime I was given a paper in my other classes, I would just try to make it funny. Like, just do a funny take on it. So.
Twist it a little bit.
Okay. Yeah, there was like this one paper we had to do about like suspense. I was like, watch like a suspenseful movie and write about like the, there was like three or five layers of suspense or something. And I was like, I hate those kind of movies. I hate thriller movies. So I just watched Caddyshack and I wrote it as though Caddyshack was like this master thriller. So it was fun. It was like, it was a great way to get out of actually doing work.
Yeah.
Just by making funny. I think teachers and professors actually enjoy it because it's like a nice break from
totally
the standard sort of bullshit that they read. So
yeah, if it fit into like a cookie cutter mold.
Yeah, if I was a teacher, I would love to get something stupid just to laugh at it. I would definitely give it an A. Like, finally, at least something lighthearted.
So when did you realize like that your kind of perception and observation of things was far different than your peers or your friends, and maybe that could be a benefit to you?
I don't know. I guess like the TV land stuff, that was one thing where I'm like, I'm definitely different than all these people because none of them know what the hell I'm talking about.
I was watching Living Single and like those sort of sitcoms, and you almost sound like,
I watched all those sitcoms too, but then when I got into high school, I was like, anything made after 1980 sucks. I don't know why.
Who said that?
I said that.
You said that.
Yeah, I was like, I don't know why I took this big stance on like anything that was new. I hated it.
Because it's just a derivative.
Aside from like
of
The
something.
Simpsons and Seinfeld, yeah, I still watched. I still loved all those shows, but for some reason I got really righteous about like, no, Dick Van Dyke, that was the best. TV will never be better than that. It's over. TV already had its golden age. It's stupid now, but
you sound like an 80-year-old person.
I know, and I felt like it too in high school because I had as many friends as most 80-year-olds do. So. Yeah, I don't know. That I guess that's kind of where I realized like, oh, you know, I really like comedy of all forms, and I was like, I knew the history of it. I loved SNL. I loved all the old SNL, new SNL.
Did you like to like imitate that? That type of stuff?
Yeah, actually, I did. I think my junior year of high school, I started this thing called Saturday Afternoon Live. Very, obviously,
I just let you
genius
into that.
Idea.
No, Christian, I knew she told me about that.
Right. So, yeah, Christian was in it. I was too embarrassed to ask any of my own friends to do it, so I just had my brother's friends in it. Like, I could boss them around, whereas, like, my actual friends, I didn't feel comfortable, like, you know, yelling at them because they fucked up their lines.
Do you have any particular skit that you remember?
God, there was so many. I was so prolific back then. I don't know what happened. It was easy to write. I don't know why. I was just like, I was churning it out. I wrote every single sketch and thing. But there was one moment where I was like, I did like a Weekend Update thing. And I remember one week where I was like, you know, I'd read all the news, do all the jokes. And one of the jokes that I did on Saturday afternoon, like that night, they did a very similar joke on Weekend Update on SNL. So I was like, oh, maybe I could do this.
Yeah.
And I was like, at the time, I was like, oh, I could do all these great impressions, even though sure they were awful.
Yeah.
My sister like made the, put them all on DVD for me for Christmas or something. I was like, I don't want to see this. No. I don't know. There was some good stuff in there.
So you're building like a little confidence. You have the support of at least some of the teachers, maybe your family. What are you talking about in terms of maybe college and what you want to study? How are you talking about that with your family?
Well, basically
like
when I was...
Be a dentist or no? Or something like that?
Yeah, no. Definitely didn't get pushed in the dentist direction.
That's good.
Weirdly, I was going to be a computer science major in college. Like, that's what I was thinking. I was like, Well, first I was like, I'm going to be a pro baseball player, so it doesn't
sure.
matter.
Right.
And then, like, I remember one of my friends was like, you're not even on the high school team. Like, and I was like, he's like, if you're not the best player in the school, how are you going to make it to the big leagues? And I was like, oh, fuck, he's right. All right, computer science it is. And so, I took computer science in freshman and sophomore year. And I was going to take AP computer science, but they couldn't fit it in my schedule. And, like, at the time I was angry. I was like, fuck, I really wanted to take this class. And
you sound angry.
Yeah. I was livid.
Yeah.
I really wanted to learn Visual Basic. But so they couldn't fit it in, so I didn't take it. And then that's kind of right around the time I started thinking about comedy. And I remember I told my guidance counselor, you know, it was like college application time and stuff like that, time to look at colleges. And I was like, I think instead of computer science, I think I want to do like comedy, television. And she said, all right, but let's be realistic for a second. I was like, that's not what a guidance counselor is supposed to do.
That's
not what you're supposed to say.
That's the worst response you can do.
What the hell? It's all good because I didn't listen to her.
Is it because you weren't boisterous, maybe?
Probably. You know, I was a quiet kid in school.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a good grades kid.
Yeah.
Not a class clown.
Right. Who hardly make it as any
Yeah, they
sort
burn
of
out.
Comedy.
That they that's all that's like the peak.
Yeah.
They burn too brightly. You know? They're great at the time, but
Run
they lack the they lack the discipline.
Yeah.
I paced myself, that was the difference.
Nice.
Yeah.
Smart.
But yeah, so kind of a scheduling fuck up at Shelton High School is what caused my comedy career. So anytime someone doesn't get into a class, you know, maybe it's not the worst.
Man, glass half full totally.
Yeah.
Cool. So, all right. So you go into, you're going to go to BU, going to be a, were going to be a computer science major.
Well,
you
no,
just,
yeah.
You sought out BU because of the writing.
Yeah, because I only applied to 3 schools, BU, NYU, and Fordham.
Okay. So this is your focus now 100%.
You're deviating. Totally. That's all I wanted. It's like...
To be what in the comedy world, though?
Comedy writer
mm-hmm. for, like, an SNL?
Probably or... SNL at the time, but, you know, I was also thinking sitcoms because I was, like, in the, you know, Dick Van Dyke.
Sure, yeah.
All in the family mindset there, so.
Was he dead at that point, or?
Dick Van Dyke? Yeah. He's still alive now.
Is he now? Yeah. Oh, my bad.
He's still crushing it, man.
That's a...
He looks younger than you or I. It's really fucked up. No, he's awesome. But definitely writing. I was never into the performing, really. Or maybe I was just, like, realistic. I was like, all right, I'm not...
Did you do drama club at all or anything
no,
like that?
No, I didn't. I didn't do any of that
So
stuff.
Just writing, doing your... Bossing your brother's friends around in home videos.
Right, yeah.
That was, like, the extent
Yeah,
okay. How
pretty
it
much, pretty much.
World. So BU, do you immediately seek, like, any sort of sketch comedy
yep.
group or...
I did.
Okay.
There was 2 groups at BU. There was one that was, like, a sketch comedy performing team. It's called Slow Children at Play. I didn't even know about them until sophomore year. But then there was this BU TV show called Overexposed, which was their sketch comedy show. So I, you know, my first semester I applied to write for that show. Basically,
are you second guessing yourself at all? Like,
no, I was too naive to.
You're not fearful at all either? You're just thinking, like, I can make this 100%?
Yeah.
Awesome.
It was just youthful being naive and stuff. Mm-hmm. So... I wrote a sketch, and then they brought me on. So it was cool. It was awesome. It definitely validated stuff. I felt good. I was like, all right, good. All right, this is good.
Do you feel like you had a home for the first time with that?
You know, to put it dramatically.
Sorry. I know. I just realized like, what I said. Like,
No. I don't think so. I don't think it was like that.
Like
deep
a
feeling.
People,
it was
like
fresh.
Of, okay.
It was freshman year, but I felt like, all right, this is good. Like, it's forcing me to write sketches and stuff. Mm-hmm. And even though maybe I think 2 or 3 of them ever got made, because it was fucked up. Because like, it was run like TV networks are run, instead of how it would be better if they just did it properly. But they it was like mini LA. So it was like we wrote these sketches, and then we sent them to the production team. And that was it. They didn't let us on set.
What?
No.
Wow.
Even when they're filming your own sketch.
Wow.
Not allowed. So you just send it off into the ether, and then maybe it gets made. It was so fucked up. It's so stupid. So it is. I'm saying it. I'm like, this is dumb.
Yeah.
Why did I accept that as like? So that's why Slow Children at Play was awesome. I never did it, but that's where I met Arthur Meyer and Seth Reese. Seth writes for Seth Meyers now. He wrote with me at The Onion. Arthur writes at Fallon now. Mm-hmm. They were in Slow Children at Play, and when I saw that, I was like, oh man, that's how it should be done.
Yeah.
Because they're writing their stuff and then they're performing it. Mm-hmm. Whereas we were just sending it off, and then like they were making the casting decisions. They were interpreting the comedy and the dialogue and the setting.
Yeah, but they don't get what you're trying to convey.
No, they don't know what
convey,
that. No, that was it. It was like you went to the like at the end of the semester that you know they screened it, and it was like you didn't even know if any of your sketches were in there. I was like, interesting. Oh, interesting. They decided to make the cop, the gruff cop in my sketch, a woman. What? Why would you make that casting decision? As far as I know, I never did stuff in L.A., but to me, that's like how L.A. works.
Mm-hmm. Just rip it apart. I mean, there's no...
Yeah, you have a vision and a bunch of other people come along and fuck it up.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Until
it sounds amazing.
Barely recognizable.
Does that make Seinfeld like an anomaly? Or because he had so much, him and Larry David were on the same page? Like, what has been there that's been more, like, almost to its purest?
I mean, Seinfeld's great, and that was, if you know the story of that, what happened is actually, and I know the guy who saved Seinfeld, his name is Rick Ludwin. He, for many years, dating back to Johnny Carson, he was the head of NBC Late Night. Mm. I believe what happened was NBC was like, I could be getting my facts wrong here, but I think they said that, you know, they're not going to have room for it in the budget for primetime. And so Rick Ludwin said, well, let me oversee it in the late night budget. So Seinfeld, even though it was on in primetime, it was a late night. It was under the the late night thing. I don't know. Check it up. I might be 100% wrong on that.
Well,
I'm pretty sure.
We'll censor everything you just said if need be.
Yeah, maybe I should keep bashing NBC
totally.
On this podcast. Maybe take all this out. No, it's not bashing NBC,
no.
But it is praising Rick Ludwin.
A misstep, and then, that guy
and
had
so
a vision of...
And so they were able to sort of do it without notes from primetime because they weren't really giving notes on it. It was under Rick Ludwin's watch, and he just let them do it.
Wow.
Oh, check it out. But Rick Ludwin is he's a genius.
Okay, so summers, are you looking for internships?
Yep.
What are you...
Yeah, I tried to get an internship one summer at Carson Daly. Did not get it.
He's the third rung on the late night show.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's on at 1:30 at night.
Yeah.
But it was to be in that building and whatever. But just didn't work out timing-wise. Like, they wanted me to start in April. I was like, I just took a train from Boston to here. I can't commute from Boston. I was in school until May. He's like, I need someone to start now. So, didn't work out.
What kind of college kid can they find that?
I don't know. Maybe he thought I was from New York or something. Yeah. But anyway, the next summer I got an internship at Conan. So I worked there for the summer of 2004. It was a great experience, you know, got to see how a show like that worked, saw the writers working, and, you know, it was just awesome. I was like, that's what I want to do. Mm-hmm. So, ended up working out many years later.
Yeah, I was going to say, did you make sure you got to know these guys, or that you
not really.
Just happened?
No, you just watch it. I didn't do much networking. In fact, I've found that most networking that helps you just happens naturally. Instead of like forcing it and stuff, but at the end of that internship, I just happened to meet there was like a big Conan hiatus party or whatever, and I met the associate editor of The Onion there, and I loved The Onion in college. Mm-hmm. I think that their website would refresh on like Tuesdays, and I would I'd be clicking refresh on my. Back then it was weekly, so. I'd like click refresh and then like the new one would pop up and I'd just read every single article. So it's so cool to get to.
How, like, I don't know. There's a feeling of what you idolize and what you consume all the time. And then actually meeting the people that are doing it? Yeah. Like, what are you just, like, calling? Like, what's going on in your mind at that point? Things seem to just be flowing one into another. You're just kind of riding the wave.
It's crazy. There's no other way to describe it other than it's insane. Weirdly, when I was in college my last year, they had everyone go around the room in one of our classes and say, like, what do you, like, want to do eventually in the field of entertainment, TV, movies, whatever. You know, some people are like, oh, you know, I don't know, I want to direct movies. And then this is the weirdest thing I've ever said, but I said, I'd love to get in on The Onion and write there. And then I'd love to get in on the ground floor if whoever takes over for Conan. Which is crazy, because that's exactly what happened. So it's weird. It's a weirdly specific thing to say and then happen. And then, but the other thing is, if Jimmy, when he was, I think it was in elementary school or middle school, I don't know, but in one of his yearbooks, he was voted most likely to replace David Letterman. Which is crazy.
Which is, he replaced his rightful throne.
Right, and and also Late Night was started by Letterman in the 80s.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Like,
weirdly,
Letterman,
you know,
should have been
Conan
the guy.
Was between them, but it was. That's crazy too.
That's nuts.
He has. I've seen it. I've seen the actual photo. It's like what is like a yearbook superlative.
Yeah. Wow.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Fate is real. That's the lesson. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's weird.
We'll use that little 2-second clip.
Yeah, that's the whole podcast. Just me saying fate is real into the camera.
It would be a great gif.
Weird.
Yeah. How are you feeling this? How did you get into from talking to that person in The Onion, do you have to submit writings to this person?
No, what happened was I did a semester in L.A., so I was in L.A. for a little bit, and I interned actually at that point. I interned at the Late Late Show.
Okay.
I was there for Craig Kilborn's last three shows, and then he had just sort of given 2 weeks' notice, and so then there was like 3 months of just guest hosting. People doing it for fun. Some people trying out for the job. Mm-hmm. One of them was Craig Ferguson.
Yep. Obviously. Yeah. So you were out there, and then.
So I was out there, and I was like. I would email The Onion. I was like, I didn't even have the email address of
somebody at The Onion.
Yeah, I was just emailing like their for more info email here. I was like, I met Amy Baradale. She's the associate editor, and I'd love to get in touch about an internship. And somehow it got to her. And there was one internship back then at The Onion. It was copy editing. That's all you did. So she was like, do you know AP style? And I was like, yes. And so, like, I bought the AP Style Guide and, like, Strunk and White and all these books about, like, you know, what to capitalize and, like, how company names are supposed to be in print. It's really interesting. And so I just learned it. And then she emailed me, like, a test, like a copy editing test. She's like, copy edit this story. I did it. She was like, all right, all good. I finished the semester early, so I moved to New York in the spring of 05, or winter of 05. And basically, they were like, you only have to come in on Wednesdays for like an hour and copy edit the paper. I was like, I live here now and I have nothing else to do, so I'll come in every day. And they're like, all right, good luck finding stuff to do, but sure. And of course, there was tons of stuff to do, but they didn't know that because, like, they were from Madison, and they did everything themselves. Like, they did, like, the grunt work themselves, like printing out stuff, transferring, like, written headlines that got picked onto, like, a master list. And I was like, no, I'll do all that. And they're like, oh, okay. And so, like, I just kind of just did everything I could to make their lives easier. Mm-hmm. And then I got hired there as the editorial coordinator. So I was like copy editing. I was basically doing anything. I was a writer's assistant, basically. Doing research, copy editing, doing all the grunt work stuff, emailing the contributors, compiling stuff. And then they would let me submit headlines every now and then. And so I think after a few weeks after I got hired, they gave me a story to write, and then the rest was just, that was it. And then they would just give me a story every week. And they were getting a lot of free labor from, not free, but I was doing all the other stuff and also writing, but it was awesome. I was just like staying up till like 3 o'clock in the morning working on stories. I was like, this is my dream.
Like how are you, are there like 1,000 tabs open on your computer screen or 1,000 newspapers out on your floor? Like where are you sourcing potential like links to comedy from?
Depending what the topic is, you just do like a lot of research on it and read other news articles that are kind of similar and go glossary pages and stuff. But my favorite ones ended up being to write the sort of slice of life ones, because those are awesome. You just kind of write how people talk. Mm. It's easy. Mm. You don't have to really mimic anything. I remember the first Onion article I wrote, I stayed up till like 3 o'clock in the morning, like, oh my God, I hope this is good. But it turned out good. But then I had to take notes on my own. Like I had to take notes when they were going over the story. So I was taking notes on, they were talking about my own story. I just had to take notes on it. It was a weird
be
position.
Be objective to the...
Yeah, it was the weird position to be in. But then I just was writing full-time, and the other stuff other people were doing. And then they started getting so many interns and stuff doing... It turned out great. Like, Will Tracy, who writes for, I believe, John Oliver now, he was the editor-in-chief of The Onion.
That's just an amazing show right
now. Yeah, they're killing it.
Yeah.
But he had interned at The Onion. It's great. Interning is great because like you sort of get a feel for what the writers like, what they don't like, sort of.
Which I assume obviously
it's easier than writing from a void. Like sometimes you get Onion headlines or you know pitches, your packets for Fallon from people who are hilarious. I know they're hilarious, and then they don't quite. It's like don't quite get the voice because you're not there every day.
Coming toward the tail end of The Onion, how did late night even come into the picture?
Well, like I said, I always wanted to.
It's free determination.
I actually found out through my friend Seth. He was like, "Oh, I'm putting together a packet for Fallon," and we had the same agent. We had gotten an agent from. There was a friend of Dan Klein's, Alan Moore. He was an agent at APA, and he was like, "Oh, all the Onion guys, you should all be represented." And I never used my agent for like a year because I was like, "I like the Onion. I don't want to do anything else." But when that came up, I was like, "Oh, I really want to do this." So I put together a packet and sent it through my agent, and so I got an interview with the executive producer. He must like me, so then I got brought back to meet with Jimmy and Shoemaker, who was the producer at the time, and Gavin Purcell, another producer. And I guess it just went well. So
what were they asking you?
It's not. They don't really ask you. It's more. I think to kind of just like see if you're a normal person, kind of like if you can get along, if you fit in.
Yeah.
So. I was actually just talking about this yesterday because Robert Plant was on the show, but when I interviewed for the job, I wore a Led Zeppelin t-shirt and shorts to the interview. It was not a typical interview attire, but it's just a comedy job, so I was like, I'm just going to wear what I would normally wear.
Yeah.
But it was funny because that was the main point of talking in the interview. Weird Led Zeppelin t-shirt. It was a weird one. It was like not like an album cover. It was like 3D... gangsta rendering of Led Zeppelin I had gotten like when I was like in high school. I still have it somewhere. I still wear it, sadly. Basically, they just talk to you for, you know, 20 minutes, and then you walk out and you're like, I have no idea if that went well, what they were looking for. It's not a quiz or anything. They don't ask you like, where do you see yourself in 5 years? They don't.
Yeah.
They don't really ask you questions like that. They just kind of.
Riff with him.
Yeah, kind of just riff and make sure that you fit in and stuff.
Cool.
So it just worked out.
Did you get a call?
Within a few days, I think, maybe. Wow. Less than a week, my agent called me and was like, you're in. You're hired. First writer at Fallon.
The first writer?
Yeah. It was when I started, it was like 4 people were there.
Yeah.
Jimmy, Gavin Shoemaker, and Gerard Bradford was there. It was crazy because it wasn't even a show yet. This was October of 2008.
Was Lorne producing it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, he's the executive producer.
He is. Yeah. Okay. All right. So when does this become like a like? When are you moving? And what are you thinking?
Two weeks.
How are friends reacting and family? 2 weeks after that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I could have had longer, but my agent, and he was right. He was like, Matt O'Shacker. He was like, I think you should get in there as soon as possible. It's like, no one else is there. Yeah. Just get in there.
Pee everywhere. Claim your territory.
Yeah. It was crazy. It was definitely nerve wracking because all I'd known was The Onion. And, you know, at the time I loved The Onion. So it wasn't like I was like desperate to get out.
Right.
But this was the one thing where I was like, this is one thing I'll leave The Onion for. Mm-hmm. I started and there was no office, nothing. They had me working. It was actually amazing because for my first 3 weeks, they just put me in a random office on the SNL floor on 17. And so like, I was like across the hall from like Amy Poehler. I was just like this guy. No one knew who I was. I was just suddenly there. I didn't work on SNL, but I was just in an office, windowless office, just like writing. People would walk by and be like, huh?
Did you have the beard at the time too?
Of course, of course.
Yeah.
Like looked like a vagrant, just wandered in and set up shop.
Somebody feed that man.
But they were all super nice. Like when they found out, that's the Fallon writer. People would walk by like, how's it going? Cool. All the nicest people in the world. And basically I just wrote Weekend Update jokes for 3 weeks. That's what they had me do. They were like, just practice jokes. I was like, I'm not really a monologue writer because I was on the sketch side. Right. They're like, just do it.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay. Just wrote a bunch of jokes. Actually got a few jokes on Weekend Update, which itself was awesome.
Do you know remember the first? I have to remember the first.
Yeah, the first joke was, Mr. Blackwell. It was some guy, I forget his name, but he was like this big fashion critic or something. But he had died at like the age of 88, and then it was like, the joke was like, so-and-so was caught dead in that outfit. That was it, just a short joke. But that was like that was the line he was known for. Like, I wouldn't be caught dead in that outfit. So I was like,
brilliant.
So it was just a quick joke that Seth Meyers did, but it was cool. I didn't even know it was airing. I wasn't even watching the show that day. I was like, at a friend's.
Was people just taking your index cards off your desk?
No. I mean, I sent them to like Jimmy and Shoemaker, and they used it. I had no idea. I didn't expect them to use any of those jokes. Then we started doing webisodes and stuff. Every day we'd shoot a webisode that would air at 12:30. It was just kind of to reestablish Jimmy and like.
How far out was that from the?
A few months. We started in like December of 08, and then the show started on March 2nd, 09.
What were you writing for him that really could showcase his abilities?
The great thing is, you know, we learned really quickly that he could pretty much do anything. Anything you throw at him, he could do it. Any impression, he can learn it, mm-hmm. or he already has it. You need him to do a dance, he's a great dancer. You need him to sing, he could sing. Play guitar. This is great. It's kind of like, here you go. Here's one of the most talented entertainers in the world. So it's kind of cool. That's, you know, after a little while, we learned like it doesn't have to just be like sitting behind the desk. You know, he could actually be of the sketches.
That was like, to do a regular monologue is not utilizing his talent. So what was the first?
The first thing where I was like, okay, I see, was when we did this bit that, it was Jimmy's idea too. It was called Let Us Play With Your Look. I don't know if you've ever seen it. We did it on Late Night a bunch of times. Really weird sketch. We did it like, I think it was like a few months into the show. It was like June of 09. And Will Ferrell was the guest. And it was a really weird sketch where Jimmy comes out from behind the curtain. He's dressed in like a white leotard. And he's got like a white Dutch boy wig on. And he's has like a gold microphone. He's just singing this song called Let Us Play With Your Look. Over and over again, he keeps going to a higher register each time he sings it. And then you cut to the crowd and coming down the stairs is like this silhouette, and it's Will Ferrell, same outfit, stoic face. And then, like, you know, he brings, it was an intern on our show. We just had someone planted in the audience, brings her down to a seat, and then, like, just starts brushing her hair, like, in swirls. And just in the meantime, Jimmy just keeps singing this Let Us Play With Your Look tune over and over again. And I remember, that was so exciting because it kind of felt like, oh, man, we could do, like, weird sketches that just have no explanation. They're not set up from the desk. They just happen. And I remember, like, going to the back of the audience to watch that from the studio because I was really excited about it. And I was like, oh, man. And it's weird because I've one of my best friends, who I actually met a couple years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, his name's Mike O'Gorman. He's a hilarious dude. He brought that up as, like, he was like, oh, that was, he was watching, he's like, I was watching Fallon from day one, and when that sketch happened, I was like, oh, I get it. This is awesome.
Yeah. Because you want to push the boundaries at a certain point.
We were on at 12:30, so it was awesome because you could kind of do or try anything. And, you know, that first year, really, we weren't on the radar, and I think it was a good thing because, you know, we had some stuff bomb, we had some stuff go great, and, you know, you just kind of learn your footing a little bit and, like, okay, this works, we could do this, we could try this, and you don't get hit for it. Whereas it's now that, you know, even when we established ourselves at late night, you don't want to take those swings and misses anymore because no one likes a whiff.
Did you feel it, feel the whiff at the beginning? Like,
of course, yeah. I had a couple things that just didn't play that well. Didn't get laughs. It's not a good feeling.
No.
Even
describe that for me. Like,
it's just empty. It's just emptiness.
Yeah.
Just you're trying to make people laugh and they are not laughing. They're staring. No one wants that. And it's not, you know, it's not good for anything. It's not good for the rest of the show. It puts the audience in a weird mood. So we tried to stop doing that. But it was good to be able to do it because that's how you learn. And being able to take some big swings, that's how you hit a home run. Mm. So we learned what we could do. We learned what could be a home run. And we learned not to strike out as much, at least try to.
So one of those swings was the Gadsden purchase.
That was
your first time on national television.
It was.
Not?
Yes.
Okay.
It was my first time acting in general, aside
in
from
all
I
the
guess,
writing.
Like,
well, you wrote for The Onion, which is just a publication, so you never had to be.
No, I never did stand up. I never did improv. I never performed.
That never even like came to.
It was just never something I was like. I was always more interested in the writing. So that was just youthful brashness. I was just like, I remember pitching. I was like, oh yeah, there's a guy in the audience and he loves the Gadsden Purchase. It's an obscure land treaty from the, like, 1850s or whatever. We were all laughing because it's so dumb.
Yeah.
And it was like after Friday of the first week, Miles, 80 Miles, the head writer, came in and was like, oh, Jimmy wants to do a Gadsden Purchase on Monday. I was like, okay. I was like, and I was like, Miles, you can play the main guy or something, or Jeselnik? And he's like, oh no, oh, by the way, Jimmy wants you to play him. I was like, what? I'm not an actor. But I just did it, and Arthur Meyer came over to my house that weekend, or my apartment. He lived across the street from me, and, you know, I showed him the sketch, and we wrote a couple extra bits of it together, and then I put him in it, I put Jeselnik in it, because I tried to put him in everything when I started because he's hilarious. I was like, this dude's fucking funny.
Yeah.
I can't believe the audience laughed at it. With the, like I said, if I knew now, having gone through years of doing the show and knowing what works, I never would have ever guessed that I would get laughs. I can't believe it did. It was just like a miracle. I always thought it was funny, but I can't believe that a crowd of people got behind that.
Yeah.
It's just a weird, weird thing.
Yeah.
Lucked out, so that was a good first performance, and it was one of my first sketches on the show. So,
awesome.
Probably my favorite ones were all the Saved by the Bell stuff I did the first year.
Are you obsessed with Saved by the Bell?
I definitely was. And
yeah, was.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I don't watch it every day now.
Well,
but,
yes. Okay. Yep.
But it's, if it's on, I'll watch it because it's, you know, it was a great show, but yeah. It's also just like nostalgia. Just,
sure.
You know, the Mark Paul thing was just amazing. That was the, at the time, I was like, I can't believe, like, he's there dressed as Zach Morris. That was his idea. He was like, I want to do this. I want to come out as Zach Morris.
I think that's touching upon a particular, you guys seem to really get the star power and the people to basically commit to anything. Like, how are you, who is it just the vibe you give off that Jimmy's just a really fun guy and everything's upbeat and they kind of can trust that?
That's exactly right. You know, that's probably the most genius thing that Jimmy did and we did at the show, which is we didn't really make celebrities look bad. We would always, you know, it's always about making them look good. He doesn't make them look bad in interviews. Just think about the terminology. It's, they're your guest, our guest tonight, and you're a host. You know, if you invite someone to be a guest, you should treat them well, you know? That's basically kind of, so it's weird. It's almost taking it literally. So once a few people did crazy swings and then they got great press for it and, you know, it came out great and everyone loved it, then other people are more willing to do that. Cause like, oh yeah, I saw this. I saw Bruce Springsteen come on and dress up as himself from the 70s and sing Whip My Hair. So, of course, who are you to not do something if Bruce Springsteen is going to play around? Mm-hmm. So that's kind of, that's basically what we established early on in the show.
Is the medium through which a lot of these things are, like, I think the Fallon Show is just the best at utilizing all the social media routes and all the ways people consume media now. Do you kind of write that in the back of your mind, like, this could be a nice 4-minute, like, consumable?
I don't think we did. I don't think we started doing that, and now we're aware of it, so of course it factors in. But, you know, we were never doing stuff like, oh, this will be viral.
Yeah.
That was never a concern. That wasn't even really that's terminology now, but it was barely terminology, I think, in 2009. Or maybe I'm just misremembering. Or we were just on at 12:30, so
right.
People weren't really paying attention. But when the Zach Morris thing did, and that was kind of the first huge thing that everyone was talking about that we did, and it was like, oh, yeah, right.
Well,
that's a great way to get word out about a show that's on at 12:30 is to have people watch it on the internet. If you do good stuff that with celebrities and stuff, then people are seeing it. They're seeing your show. They're aware of it, even if they're not physically watching it, and that's what helped us, I think, have a good audience when we started at 11:30. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. People already knew what the show was about based off like the clips, even if they weren't staying up to watch it.
Was the late night show ever struggling in a sense? Like, and no, not at all. Just everything was pretty much...
The 12:30 show it's pretty much based entirely on how well the 11:30 show is doing. It's people leaving their TV sets on, basically. So... It was like if Leno had a good night, we had a good night. So it's a little more in your mind at 11:30, but at 12:30, never really thought about that.
Gotcha. Okay. Cool. Maybe if you want to go, maybe one other big sketch that you remember from the late night show, and then when you transitioned into the Tonight Show, and what that kind of felt like when you got word of that.
I think even it might still be my favorite sketch, because it was kind of like the first one where I was like, yeah, this is it's everything I love. It was the Jimmy as Neil Young singing the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air theme song. And it was just,
that's what we were talking about before, like bringing the most, like Saved by the Bell and Neil Young would never be.
Right. So when you write stuff, you have a certain vision of how it'll turn out. And it, since it's, you know, sort of live to tape, but you know it's live, and there's so many other factors that it rarely ever matches exactly what you wanted it to be. It's usually awesome, but it's very rarely gets exactly what you want. And that one was just, to me, perfect. It was like he looked like Neil Young. The wardrobe was amazing. The way they shot it was amazing. His impression is impeccable. It's just so cool, and the audience got it. Like, definitely just one of the coolest moments. And it's like, I love classic rock. I love 90s TV shows like Fresh Prince. So it was just like a perfect melding of everything. And that just, and then we did a lot of music stuff on the show after that. And it was just always fun. Music is just fun. Mm-hmm. And Jimmy's great at it.
Parodies, real ones.
Yeah.
Impersonations.
Yeah, it's.
He does them all very well.
Yeah.
So like, when did you get word that he would be, was that like 8 months out or something like that? That Leno would hand it off to?
Yeah. That was when it was official. It was like maybe a rumble here and there, but you know, obviously once Leno came back and Conan went to TBS, in the back of your mind, you know, like, well, he's not going to do this forever. Mm-hmm. So you're kind of thinking like, this will probably happen at some point. But then I think it was like March or April of 2013.
Sorry, from the beginning of time, what would the writing staff look like? Did people come and go? Did you just add on more writers? Did it balloon up? Who else was with you?
It was me and Gerard and Amy and Bashir and Diallo. We were the first sketch group, and then the monologue writers was Jeremy Bronson and Anthony Jeselnik and John Reinman. And only a few of us are still there. You know, people left, did other stuff.
With the performance aspects in mind or with other writing?
Some performance, some other writing stuff. Mm-hmm. A lot of people moved to LA. The writing staff we have now is great, and we have a bunch more monologue writers. There's like 5 or 6, and they're just nailing it. The monologue now is great. It was always good, but you know, it just got better and better, and now it's longer, and you know, there's lots of moving parts to it, and it's fun to watch him and Higgins.
Yeah, the interaction is,
it's amazing. It's like you're watching like a two-man improv show. Like, they're just, you know, they worked together for a long time at SNL, so they just know each other, they know their rhythms. It's amazing to watch. It's like,
Like, you know Jimmy from the writing aspect. You're basically, I feel like you're one with him at this point too. Like, how well have you gotten to know?
You know, you have a good sense of what he likes and what he wants to do, and what he can do, which is pretty much anything. And a lot of the best ideas are his, Jimmy's. He'll just riff on something. Someone will say a word, and then he'll just like somehow take the word, turn it into something completely different, and it's hilarious. It's like, how the fuck did he do that? but it's inspiring. It's amazing. It's like, I can only imagine, like, it's a dream to have someone who can inspire you to do all this stuff. Like, he'll do a voice or a character or come up with an idea. And basically, you just kind of have to, like, figure out the structure and actually physically put the words on paper, but he gives it to you. It's all there. You just gotta know when to pick it out. Like, oh yeah, that'll be a funny sketch. That'll be a funny bit. That'll be a funny tag to that joke. That'll be a funny thank you note. You know.
Do you think it's easier because he's so open to pretty much anything? Does stuff get rejected immediately, and you kind of feel?
You kind of just gotta trust his instincts 100%. Mm-hmm. If he's not feeling something, it's like, all right, good.
No, let's hard not feelings. Do it. Next one, you got like
not at all.
10 in the bet. Yeah.
No. He knows exactly what he's doing, so it's great. If he doesn't like something, you don't get mad. You're like, ah, man, that would have been funny. He should have done that. It's like,
have you brought it up a second time ever?
No. It, if he doesn't like it, it's not going to be good because you know you want stuff that he's invested in. You don't want him to force someone, and I think that's true of writing for anyone. You got to write to something that they're excited about, something that they want to do, something that they can do, something that's in their voice. Otherwise, it could be the funniest thing in the world, but it won't be funny with people that's not into it. Hmm. Always the best stuff is the stuff that he's on board with right away. You don't have to sell him on it. Our goal, I think, is just to put on the most fun show to make and watch. it sounds stupid and simple, but you're just trying to entertain people.
Have certain guests been surprising in their, I guess, capability to really bring something? I've seen, I mean, John Hamm's now a staple, but like, who would have thought that the guy from Mad Men at the beginning, now he's on 30 Rock SNL of your show.
I mean, basically celebrities are amazing. It sounds stupid and it's like, they're just the same as us, but it's like, they're kind of magical. Things that they can do. There's one bit that it was Jimmy's idea, and I can't even believe that it worked, that it happened, that he thought of it. I don't know if you saw it, but we were thinking of ideas for Halle Berry, and Jimmy was like, oh, maybe we could do like one of those like two-person forward roll things, like it's like some gymnastics move. Have you ever seen it? It's like a human hamster wheels, like people grab legs, and the other person lays down and grabs your legs, and the guy jumps, and then they just like ba-dump, 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 and roll across the floor, and it looks crazy. It looks like it looks painful or impossible, or you need to be a stunt person to do it. You know, Jimmy was like, oh yeah, I could do that with Halle Berry, and I was like, there's no, and they didn't even rehearse it. I was like, there is no way that this is going to work, especially on the first try. They just walk over there. I don't think Halle Berry's even ever done that before. And it just happens. And you're like, I'm serious. They did not rehearse it. They did it in one try. You get mad. You're like, God damn it. Fucking celebrities there. fucking so good.
Give me some of your magic dust.
God damn, it's crazy. Yeah, you do. You're like, what the hell? Like Timberlake, like he's insane. He's so talented.
Oh, yeah. Let's go.
It's crazy.
I mean, that's the greatest like bromance that there is right now is Jimmy and Justin.
Well, they're similar people in that they're so talented at everything. Like, you know, Timberlake's a musician first and foremost, but he's also hilarious.
Yeah.
Really great sense of humor and timing and all that.
Yeah, he doesn't, and nothing's off limits, it seems.
Yeah, and Jimmy is on the other side of that coin. He's a comedian who's extremely talented as a musician. Mm-hmm. So they're kind of like yin and yang of music and comedy. And it's just, you can write anything and they'll knock it out of the park every time. It's awesome. Like the history of rap stuff, they rehearse that like once or twice, like the day of, and then they just nail it. It's crazy. They're doing like 18 rap songs. It's insane. No one should be able to do that. It's insane. It's fun. It's cool to see. It's just like you're in awe every day. You're like,
but you're the one feeding them all the
I mean, it's not hard. They're so talented, Jimmy especially. It's like you can give him anything, you know, he'll knock it out of the park. Yeah, it's a great feeling.
How is he on all the time?
I mean, he's been on TV since, you know, 1998. Yeah. He's since he was 24. Just how he is. Yeah. I think you just get used to it.
Turns it on, yeah.
Even behind the scenes, he's hilarious. He's always doing bits. It's amazing.
You're always looking for what to find funny and comical, even in the slightest sense,
right,
probably.
Right. Yeah, or sometimes I'm just watching baseball games. I'm not really always looking for comedy, but it's cool to have that sort of muse, I guess. To put it that way,
yeah.
Just like, yeah, you have one of the most talented people in the world, and then every day a flood of other talented people.
Do you just look at all these celebrities as resources, and you can kind of pluck and shoot like, oh, well, this thing would be great for...
No, you know, I look at them as human beings first, but then, yes, then I look at them as cogs in my, you know, comedy,
put a place
the comedy machine of The Tonight Show.
Like, oh, this would be great for this celebrity that I've never met, but we could probably get him next week, potentially.
Yeah. You just look at the calendar, and every day it's like a huge star, and, you know, that just inspires you. You're like, oh, yeah, we could do something awesome with this person. We could do something awesome with them.
Well, let's end it with Mets bucket hat guy and just and just talk about, like, where that came from. And is that, like, it seems like an improv exercise almost of how to... how to link things together.
I mean, Yeah, I mean, basically, that started me and Haskell would. A few years ago, we were trying to like freestyle rap, and we both realized that we're awful at the rhyming part of it, which is really the main thing.
Yeah,
you need.
Rapping. Yeah.
But it's also easy to just sort of connect things, just for fun. And then when Jimmy hosted the Emmys, we needed like an intro for him to introduce Matthew Perry and Lauren Graham, and for some reason that was the one that we could not crack. We couldn't figure out like a funny line for him to say to introduce them. So everyone was just banging their heads against the wall, and I wrote something where he just connects their two names in that way. That was the first time he had seen that bit. But you know, me and Haskell would do it every now and then. And so he liked that one and he did it at the Emmys. And then I was just like, oh, you know, we could probably turn that into like a sketch. And then I pitched it, and he was like, and he came up with the idea of like, oh, you should get sad, walk out the studio and like keep turning around and then going back. That was all him. That was all his idea. Yeah. For some reason, some people like it. I don't understand why.
The elongated sad leave is, that's a great.
Yeah, no, that's fun. That's always the easiest part.
Yeah.
Because you don't have to do anything. You just have to just look, just stare. That's great. but that was awesome. I got to go to Citi Field earlier this summer.
You're a Mariners fan. You're not even a...
Yeah, don't tell the Mets people that.
I will not say...
I like the Mets. They're my NL team.
Sure. Who could hate them, really?
They're the lovable...
Right.
The lovable New York team. I love baseball. That's like, besides comedy, that's like the thing I love.
You're gonna be a major leaguer.
And I still might be able to. I'm only 31. I can still.
Are you the best baseball player on the Tonight Show?
I think I am. I don't know. We play softball. I'm pretty good.
Yeah.
I mean, softball's not baseball.
Cool, dude. Yeah, that's.
Anything that's else? It's all good. Thanks, man.
Wait, can I get that one more time?
What?
That's there too.
All right. Let's do this naturally.
Cool.